Ah, there, look.
So okay, so now, so far the first lectures has been very much just somehow a general introduction what we're doing. So now we actually start with some real things to learn. And this is basis of almost all bioinformatics, and this is alignments. And actually this is the wrong link, I realize I haven't updated it, but on the web page there are basically there's a couple of Wikipedia pages that you should read and go through. So it is I really think you should understand the algorithm. It's really fundamental things of almost everything you do later. So I will try to go through it today, and please interrupt me if things are unclear, because this is very, very basic. So I will start talking about what is an alignment, and then I will tell you how to get an alignment. So why do we need alignments? Alignment means that you have two or more sequences that you sum, so basically strings or text, and you somehow align to each other. And every position here should be somehow related to each other. So in the ideal, it should actually be that in some ancestral sequence, these two originate from the same place, so if they align together. So this is the goal. So we want to do alignment, it's very much to take homology. The definition of homology is that two proteins have a common ancestor. Which is, so basically, and then if you look at two positions here, it means these have a common ancestor. So once upon a time, there was existing a protein that had only the aligned position here, maybe something else, but in the case these two positions here were the same in some other organism or some other gene or something like that, but once upon a time it was like that. So really, and the key to do that is, of course, we want to get alignment, and if you do good alignment, you can detect homology. So we want to know it's a bit of moment 22 that we have, like we use the alignment to detect homology and use homology to get a good alignment, but it's really we want to detect proteins that have common ancestors. And then we use it to study evolution, we use it to predict functions, because the assumption is that two proteins are homologous, the proteins that have similar functions. And that is, of course, it's more true the more similar they are. But it's also, there are exceptions, but in general it's a good assumption. And we will discuss a bit when it holds, when it doesn't hold. We also use it for modeling 3D structures. If you have, we can basically use the same idea. If you have one protein, we notice its 3D structure of, and another one where we don't, we can basically use alignment and map the unknown structure onto the known one, and then use some quite simple chemistry and build a model. So this has been a lot of research for the last 40 years. You know, getting the optimal alignment, how can I get best alignments, and so how do we do it? So the idea, so homologs, so people, the word homology is often misused. Often it's said that the sequences are similar, therefore they are homologous. But it's really the other way around. So homologs really means that I have a common ancestor. It doesn't really say anything about sequence similarity. It doesn't have to be similar, but it's just that I have a common ancestor. It's just that in cases they're not similar in the sequence, we cannot really detect it. Because it's just basically we have lost it, but it doesn't mean they're not homologous. It's just that we cannot find it. Or at least with the current method we're using now, we cannot find it. Maybe if we have a better method, we can find it. But basically, so the homology has nothing really to do with sequence similarity, but it's just that it's our best proxy for finding homology is to use sequence matches. So looking at things that are similar in sequence. And I will discuss more about that later. And homology then can occur in two different ways. It can either be gene duplication or speciation. So either speciation is basically when two species diverge, like in Darwinian species. And if they have one here, especially one here, they don't interbreed any longer, so they have separate groups, separate populations. And then, of course, you have, after some time, the genes will not be identical. So they will have be different, and then the two different genes will be homologous, because they're the same gene. And the more time that passes, the more different they will be. But it's also, that also varies very much from gene to gene, and some genes evolve fast, some genes evolve slow, etc. But it also means that also that, as I said, if you have a high sequence similarity, as I said, of the indicated homology, but doesn't prove it, but it's statistically it should be like that. And also the idea that if you have high sequence similarity, you have similar CD structure, or if you have homologous, you have similar CD structures. There are exceptions, but in general that's true. So the other way of instead of duplication, a speciation is duplication. So basically you can have you can have a gene that was say assuming the common ancestor of mouse and human, there was only one copy. In mouse still only have one copies, but in human we have two copies, because there have been duplications of genes. It's kind of common that part of the DNA is got copied. It's even like happened in for instance, cheese. It's been at least two rounds of whole genome duplication. So the genome basically doubled in size. And then after that, of course, many genes disappeared. You don't need two copies of a gene, but about 100 or 200 is still remains. So you have two copies of them. And there are many copies. So for instance, you can look at the GPCR, so the olfactory receptors, the smell receptors, we have hundreds of these, and the dogs or the mouse have many more. They have a few hundred, they have 600, because they are, it's not because they have evolved to have more applications of these, or we lost them, I'm not really sure. Because they have, for them it's more important to smell than for us. So, you have two types of homology. You have the ones that are applied by speciation, actually often called orthologs, and you have one that's called by duplication called paralogs. This is something we'll talk about when we talk about phylogeny in the next week, or maybe 2 weeks from now. But there are also cases where you have things that look similar, but they are not homologous. For instance, typical example are these wings, the bats and the butterfly. The wings look a bit similar, but they certainly are not homologous evolved. They are really the common ancestor of bats and butterflies did not have any wings at all. So they have all, and the other things are that even proteins, they are